So as usual, we're recording worship today to post on our Facebook page and our website. And if you would prefer that your image not appear, you can block it using the stop video button in the lower left-hand corner of your Zoom screen next to the mute button. And you can also change your name for privacy by clicking on the three dots that appear in your own display box, scroll down and click rename. And we will begin recording now. Good morning. Welcome to Beneficent Congregational Church, United Church of Christ. Gathered in 1743, physical distancing since 2020. Welcome on this 14th Sunday after Pentecost, when we will hear a newly discovered parable of Jesus and share communion. Grab some bread and juice of any kind to have ready, and remember the Holy Spirit can work with anything. I'm so glad you logged on to Zoom today, whether you are sitting in your kitchen table with a cup of tea, or in bed with the covers tucked under your chin, or dialing in from your car, welcome. Welcome to people of all colors, sexual orientations, and gender identities and expressions, all body shapes and sizes, all ages, and everywhere along the spectrum of physical, mental, and emotional health and well-being, because you are here. This body of Christ is whole and perfect. I am Pastor Elizabeth, and I invite you to ground yourself. Put your hand over your heart and take a deep breath and just say the words, holy, holy, holy. We'll continue our worship now in song.
Holy One, we worship you.
Let's gather together and get and join each other in these words of gathering. In this hour of worship, let us lift our prayers in the name of the Creator who fashioned the world and breathed the breath of life for us. Let us lift our prayers in the name of the Christ who embraced the world and stretched out his hand to us. Let us lift our prayers in the name of the Spirit who encompassed the world and blessed our souls with yearning. Let us lift our prayers together. God, thou who art over us, thou who art one of us, thou who art, give me a pure heart that I may see thee, a humble heart that I may hear thee, a heart of love that I may serve thee, a heart of faith that I may abide in thee. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you and also with you. Let us greet one another.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning,
good morning, everyone.
Good morning, everyone.
Hello, Virginia.
Good morning.
Blessings to all.
Good morning, Lon.
Morning, Carol Ann.
Morning. I keep jumping. I got a bee keeps bothering me.
Morning, Tracy.
Good morning.
Morning, Irene.
Good morning,
everyone.
Good morning,
Jane.
Good morning, Mike.
Good morning,
everybody.
Good morning.
Love,
love. Good
morning.
Adrian Butcher.
Hey there, Harry.
Is Adrian there?
Morning.
Hey, Bill. Hey, Pastor Jermaine, yeah. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Pastor Elizabeth, I'm fine. Thank you.
I am well. Good to see everybody.
Pastor Jermaine.
Morning, Jermaine.
Morning, Jermaine.
Morning.
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 Hey, Mr. Sean, how are you?
Alive. How are you?
I'm doing good.
Good morning to all. Good morning, Pastor Elizabeth. Good morning, Tracy. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning. Good morning.
It's so good to see everybody. So let's go ahead. And we have a few announcements. If you are new to Beneficent and joining us for the first time, welcome. Send us a message through our Facebook page or email us through the website, beneficentchurch.org. I'll reach out to say hello and we'll send you the e-newsletter. Mark your calendar for Pastor Jermaine's ordination service, Sunday, October 11th at 3 p.m. We will send out a Zoom link soon. Pastor Jermaine is with us this morning, as you can see, to share in worship. Amen. And he will be with us again 2 weeks from today to preach. Amen. Tomorrow is Labor Day. The office will be closed and all the staff will be off. And I will additionally be on vacation this whole coming week. And if you have a pastoral emergency, please reach out to Pastor Cleo. She's taking a day off today, but she will be back to work tomorrow, or at least available for emergencies tomorrow. A week from today, we will dedicate our offering from our SOAR jars for the Rhode Island Coalition Against Domestic Violence. On Sunday, please count the money in your jar and make a donation through our online giving form or send a check to the church with SOAR offering in the memo line. After next Sunday, we're giving the jars a little break for a while, but hold on to them. Don't discard them. We'll continue worship now with the anthem. Thank you.
to steal my joy. Oh my goodness, I loved that. Thank you, Brother Ernest and Lon and all of the choir. Oh, there ain't nothing gonna steal our joy. It was so wonderful to see the church and remember it and know that we will get to go back to it. Welcome, young and young at heart. Today I'm gonna talk to you about Sharpies and promises. But first I wanna tell you a little story about my daughter. A few years ago, we decided to start homeschooling her because she was having some medical and emotional issues that were making school really, really difficult. And our first year of homeschooling was awesome. Our second year of homeschooling was okay. Our third year was last year, and by the end of October, we had both realized that homeschooling was just not working anymore. So we decided she would go back to school. But starting her back at school wasn't an easy process. First, we had to get her tested for learning differences. And we had hoped she'd be able to start school in January, but unfortunately the testing wasn't completed yet. And then we hoped she would start in February, but unfortunately there were communication issues between her doctors. Finally, we got a start date for March 16th, and we were both so excited. We even wrote it on the calendar in her bedroom with a big fat Sharpie. We finally had a promise of when things would change and hopefully start to get better. Something else happened on March 16th. I don't know if you remember that day, but we remember it very clearly in this house. Because instead of it being my daughter's first day back at school, that was the day that the schools closed for COVID-19. And they never reopened. Oh man, was my daughter upset. She was angry, she was sad, and I was upset too. I mean, we had realized that being home together all day was no longer a good thing. And here we were stuck doing it for months. She was so mad one day that she even took out the black Sharpie and she scribbled out the entire month on the calendar. But one thing that helped her through that time was talking about how some things shouldn't be written in Sharpie. There's an expression, it isn't etched in stone. And it means that sometimes things can change. Etching in stone and writing in Sharpie suggests something permanent, and we have to be careful not to promise something that might change. We humans, we really like certainties and guarantees. We like to plan and know that our plans will happen exactly as we expect them to. We like to make promises about the future, even though we're constantly being reminded that it doesn't always work out the way we promise. Really, the only promises that we should probably make are that we're gonna keep showing up to do our best and that we will try to follow the word of God as we go through our lives. And when it comes to calendars, pencils are a much better idea than Sharpies, because who knows what God might have in store for us. Anyway, over the summer, we began talking about the fall school year. August 31st was the new date that we had to look forward to, but this time we didn't write anything in Sharpie. Just because schools were supposed to open on that day, we both knew that they might not. So instead, we would say to each other, who knows what school will look like, but God will help us figure it out. We had learned that school starting wasn't a Sharpie-worthy promise. And sure enough, the governor announced there was a delay in opening. And my daughter was bummed again, but not like in March. Then this week, we got the announcement that while school was gonna start on time, she wouldn't be going to school in person until at least October, if not at all. And when I told her, she sighed, and then she shrugged, and she said, well, at least we know God's Sharpie promises to help us figure it out. And you know, God makes a lot of Sharpie promises to us. Throughout the Old Testament, God promised us a Messiah. But nobody knew when or how. God didn't offer any specific details, just that when it was time, a Messiah would come to lead us. And finally, Jesus came and that promise was fulfilled. Then God promised that Jesus would be resurrected, that we would have life after death, and even that God would come back to earth again someday. But no matter how much we read the Bible, there is still so much we don't know for certain and can't predict. The promises that God does give are Sharpie promises. Much like what we realized about how to navigate COVID world and school, God doesn't make promises with dates or solid expectations. God's promises are about what we need to endure the unexpected and the complicated parts of life. God promises to love us always. God promises to be there when we ask for help. God promises that we will be part of God's kingdom forever and that in death there will still be life. Those are Sharpie promises that we can write down and know we will never need to cross them out. So as you're going through your days and you find yourself facing disappointment or confusion over something changing that you thought was definite, remind yourself of God's Sharpie promises and know that you'll be able to get through anything that comes your way. Please join me in prayer. Dear God, thank you for loving us and giving us strength when life is hard. Help us to remember that our plans are not promises, and that the only real promises we need are that you are always with us and will guide us through our lives if we hold you in our hearts. Amen. And now I'd like to share with you our last video message from Joshua Maria Garcia about the upcoming youth and young adult education programs. Many people have been asking how these classes are going to be different from the regular adult Bible studies classes. So this week's video is a little glimpse into how conversations might go in a class with some help from our current middle school students and friends. So without further delay, here is Joshua. Here he comes.
Hi friends, I'm Joshua Maria Garcia, youth and young adult educator at Beneficent Congregational Church. Today I'm going to be answering some interesting questions about what the Bible has to say about macaroni and cheese.
What does the Bible say about mac and cheese?
This one is a little bit difficult, but when Job was complaining about his suffering, he said, "Do not pour me out like milk and curdle me like cheese." The Bible never says that Jesus tripped or fell, but Catholic tradition teaches in the Stations of the Cross that Jesus fell while carrying it. Proverbs 24:16 says, "For the righteous falls seven times and rises again, but the wicked stumble in times of calamity."
Joshua, what does the Bible say about the movie Up?
Joshua, what does the Bible say about chickens?
How often I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were not willing. What do you think about that?
Hey, Joshua, what does the Bible say about transformers?
Romans 12, verse 2 says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect."
Joshua, what does the Bible say about pomegranates?
Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 8 describes the promised land as a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees, and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey. You know what I want to know? What does the Bible say about my favorite movie of all time, the Lego Movie?
See you later, alligator.
Don't!
Joshua, what does the Bible say about Trump?
Oh boy. Does it ever.
Interesting topic.
Interesting, you should ask. What does the Bible say about Trump?
Special thanks is due for the completion of this video project to Amy, our Director of Christian Education, and Michelle, our Office and Communications Manager. They helped so much with getting this done, getting it uploaded. Thanks also to all the youth who sent in their videos, sometimes twice. And thanks to my chickens, Cholula and Franks, who appeared in the clip about chickens. Have a great week.
So I don't know about you, but lots of exciting different ways of looking at life and ways to talk about the Bible. If you've missed Joshua's previous videos, you can view them on the Beneficent YouTube channel. And Rally Day is next Sunday, and all of our Christian Ed programs are starting that day, and I'm so excited to connect with everybody. I hope you'll help us spread the word about all of our programs, and I think that's it. Have a blessed week.
Little children, welcome. Earth is yours to live in. Arms of love protect you. Little children, welcome.
A reading from the Revelation to John. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. God will dwell with them. They will be God's peoples. And God will be with them in person. God will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Those who conquer will inherit these things, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb. And the city has no need of sun or moon to shine on it. For the glory of God is its light, and its lamp is the Lamb. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it. Its gates will never be shut by day, and there will be no night here. People will bring into it the glory and the honor of the nations." Here ends the reading.
Thank you, Sage. Will you all pray with me? O God, speak, for we are listening. Have you heard the parable of the parking lot gate? It is a recent entry in the Gospel according to Beneficent. Let me share it with you. Jesus put before them a parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a church in downtown Providence. The church was located next door to a college campus. As the students walked from one part of campus to another, they liked to take a shortcut through the church's parking lot. All day long, every weekday, they streamed through the parking lot, heedless of the cars pulling in and out of the parking spots. The drivers had to take care not to hit the students with their cars. It made the church staff anxious. They were worried someone was going to get hurt. The staff called a meeting to discuss what to do. In the church basement, they found an old gate. They asked the custodian to install the gate at one end of the parking lot. The gate would prevent students from cutting through. The custodian installed the gate with a strong padlock to keep the gate shut. That night, someone cut off the lock with bolt cutters and reopened the gate. The next day, the students streamed through the parking lot just as before. The custodian closed the gate again and installed a new lock. Again that night, someone cut off the lock. Let anyone with ears listen. The disciples said to Jesus, "Explain to us the parable of the parking lot gate." He answered, "The parking lot and the church are the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven does not belong to the church staff or even the church members. It belongs to the neighborhood. It is a great marketplace for the exchange of ideas and the forming of friendships while people walk together. It is a place where people can meditate on the words of wisdom published in the signboard on the side of the church. It is a place where queer and trans people can find a special message posted on the front of the church, telling them they are loved. It is a place with a lush, shaded public park where people might rest and delight their senses. It is a place with steps where youth can practice skateboarding and elders can sit and work crossword puzzles. It is a place where anyone can go inside midweek to pray or meditate or think. All those people may never come to worship on Sunday morning, but during the week, they too are the people of God. And this is their kingdom of heaven." Then the disciples asked, "But who is the one with bolt cutters?" Jesus answered, "The one with bolt cutters is a prophet. He is not malicious. He is a voice crying out in the neighborhood saying, 'Don't lock us out. The kingdom of heaven belongs to us too.'" Then the disciples said, "But Jesus, what about the safety of the students? How can the church prevent someone from getting hurt in the parking lot?" Jesus answered, "The church will have to find another way." Then Jesus said, "One day, you will hear the prophecy of John of Patmos, who said of the kingdom of heaven, 'Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'See, the home of God is among mortals. God will dwell with them. They will be God's people, and God will be with them in person. God will wipe every tear from their eyes. I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb. And the city has no need of sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God is its light, and its lamp is the Lamb. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings on the earth will bring their glory into it. Its gates will never be shut. And Jesus said to the disciples, "Have you understood all this?" And they answered him, "Yes." Amen.
Thank you, Ernest. That's such a great prelude to our next part of the service where everyone can participate. Family, it is now prayer time. And God has been dealing with me with a lot of stuff regarding just my ministry in general, as I do a lot of reflection over the past few months. And oftentimes I am called to pray at the most randomest times. And for me, I'm very intentional, very strategic. I usually have everything planned out. You all know I'm a manuscript preacher. I don't do the extemporaneous thing, but God has been removing me and shifting me out of my comfort zone. And so usually, and I don't know why God is doing this, but I'm guessing God is preparing me for some other great challenges in life, in my ministry. And so I decided not to write out my prayer this morning. And so I'm going to let the Holy Spirit lead me in prayer, because this is what I feel God is calling me to do. But during this season, I want you all to please feel free to put your petitions in the chat, and just really, as I'm praying, I want you all to pray along with me. Pray along with me. We are going through a lot right now in this world. And not only do we need prayer, we need each other. So are there any prayers, any petitions that we would like to lift up to the body? If so, please say it out loud or place it in the chat. Prayers for traveling, grace and mercies as someone travels to work. Prayers for those who have had heart surgery. Yes. Prayer for our country in these upcoming elections. We know that we live in a divisive time, and we're seeing things that I've never seen in my adult life, that my grandparents seen back in the day. And it seems like history has repeated itself, but we know that we can, with God, we can get through these tedious months. Racism in the Rise family. Well, give us wisdom, yes. Give us wisdom as we navigate the reopening of schools, both colleges and high schools and elementary schools. Be with us, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. We, yes. Yes, Lord. So God, you see the prayers. God sees you. God sees you. God sees you. God sees you. Lord, you've seen the prayers and you know the ones spoken and unspoken, God. So before we come to you asking for prayer, God, we say thank you. Thank you for allowing us to be here in this virtual space, God. We thank you that in this first Sunday of September, the last quarter of 2020, that you have allowed us to be here despite the calamities, despite the pandemic, despite the loss, the heartaches, despite the financial insecurities, we are still here. We are still breathing. We have life. Life to give you praise and to worship you. We thank you. We do not take this opportunity lightly, God. We thank you. We praise you that we are able to gather virtually with this congregation, God, and see each other. For we miss being in community with each other, God. It is so good to see each other and see the face of our fellow brothers and sisters and cousins in ministry, God. We thank you for this church. We thank you for the leaders. We thank you for all those who have played a part in making sure that this ministry goes forward and not just survives through this pandemic, but thrive during this pandemic, God. And we thank you for a thriving ministry, God. Now, God, I ask that you touch those who are in need of prayer, who are in need of healing. Strengthen them and encourage them as they go forth through this thing called life that doesn't often have a blueprint. God, we know that you are the author and the finisher of our faith, God. So I ask that you cover those who are dealing with sickness and health challenges. Whether if it's mental or physical health, God, I bind the spirit of depression right now in the name of Jesus. Strengthen those who feel weak, who feel as if that they cannot make it. God, we know that you have called them to great purpose, Lord. And this is not the end, Lord. This is not the end. This is just the beginning. And there is life. There is much life ahead, Lord. God, we pray for our elder brothers and sisters in the body who are struggling with the effects of this pandemic and this virus, God. Oh, God, give them the strength to make it and to endure. God, for all those who are broken by ailments, broken by physical relationships, broken by disappointments, God, heal their hearts. Let the Holy Spirit comfort them, Lord. Oh, God. We ask that you send a hedge of protection around those who are struggling financially, who are not in a safe space emotionally and financially, Lord. We ask that you bless them and in their lives to bless them as they go forth, Lord. Lord, cover our children as we go back to school. Cover those, our teachers, our principals, our professors, everyone who has something to do with the reopening of our schools, Lord. Make it safe. Make it safe so we can be able to play and laugh and enjoy each other. God, I ask a special blessing for my students at Brown. They traveled from near and far to Providence. God, I ask that you limit outbreaks on our campus, Lord, so that we may have a thriving year. Because even though we often send people home, we have some students that have no home to go to, who are broken, where there's much physical and emotional abuse. So God, I ask that you protect them as they transition into a new academic year, God. We pray for those who are continued victims of racism, police brutality and violence, Lord, and systemic issues of injustices. We pray for those who have succumbed to state-sanctioned violence, Lord. Protect our brothers and sisters from all hues, Lord. God, let us see the humanity in each other. All humanity in another. And let people know that we are people, we are humans. We have lives, we have family, we have a spirit, we have a soul. And we're not just some random person walking down the street, God. We thank you. We thank you for what you are going to do. We know that this has not been an easy year, but this has been an eye-opener. So God, I ask that you cover our country and cover our leadership as we go down to the wire when it comes to these elections. Lord, be with every voter. Make it so that there are no malfunctions. And let justice prevail, God. God, we know that you are the author and the finishers of our faith. So God, we thank you for what you are going to do. That even though that we may not be here physically together, God, we know that we are with each other. We're walking with each other, God. And that you are walking and you're talking with us, God. Helping us navigate this thing called life, God, which is not easy. So God, we are thankful that one day we will return to the meeting house once again. God, we ask that you teach us how to pray, just like you taught your disciples by saying, Our Father, Mother Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
Give, not out of habit nor out of necessity, but out of the fullness of our gratitude to God. Let us receive our Let us pray together. Generous God, in Christ we have known a love that will not let us go. Through our offerings, we let that sturdy love reach out into our church and our community. Receive these gifts of our treasure and ourselves, we pray. Amen.
Beloved, this is the table, not of the church, but of the Lord Jesus. It is spread for those who love Jesus and who want to love him more. So come, you who have much faith and you who have little, you who have been here often and you who have not been here for a long time, you who have tried to follow and you who have failed. Come not because I invite you, it is Jesus who invites you. It is his desire that those who want him should meet with him here.
Let us begin with the comforting words of the 23rd of Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. In the name of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Comforter, peace be to this house and to all for whom this is home. Hear the words of Jesus Christ. I am the bread of life. Anyone who comes to me shall not hunger. Anyone who believes in me shall never thirst. In Luke's gospel, we read that Jesus, at the table with two of the disciples, took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them, and their eyes were open. And they were recognized, and they recognized that the risen Christ and the breaking of the bread. In the Acts of the Apostles, we read that as much as the church was gathered, often in the homes of believers, Christians devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings and community, to the breaking of the bread and to the prayers. Jesus Christ, the bread of life, we gather at your table to know you in the breaking of bread.
Let us pray. Jesus Christ, present with us now, for all that you have done and all that you have promised, what have we to offer? Our hands are empty. Our hearts are sometimes full of wrong things. We're not fit to gather up the crumbs from under your table. But with you is mercy and the power to change us. So as we do here what you did in an upstairs room, send down your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and cup, that they may become for us your body, healing, forgiving, making us whole, and that we may become for you your body, loving and caring in the world until your dominion comes. Amen. the gifts of God for the people of God. Let us partake together. Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me." And with the cup also, do this in remembrance of me.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you that in this sacrament, you assure us of your goodness and love. Accept our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, and help us to grow in love and obedience that we may serve you in the world and finally be brought to that table where all of your saints feast with you forever. O divine creator, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Send us out in the power of your spirit to live and work for your praise and glory. Amen.
Someday we'll be together, Beneficent. And until then, the worship is now ended and the service begins. Go in peace to love and serve Jesus. Amen.
Wish you all a blessed week.
Carol Ann.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, Carol Ann.
Yep. Have a blessed one. Bye.
Where are you, Carol?
I'm at Clarice's house in Central Falls.
Okay.
Oh, Clarice, hello.
Clarice, good. Everybody said hello. He said hi.
Have a great week. Bye-bye, everybody.
Have a great week.
Bye-bye now.
Take care.
Merry Ryder, how are you doing?
Love ya.
Where's Miss Lucy?
Good week. Hi, Joyce.
Sleeping on the rug.